Hi viewers, today in our botany online classroom we are going to discuss about herbarium preparation and applications of the herbarium topic. So it is covered under BSc Life Sciences first year semester 2 botany under taxonomy. So now we are going to discuss about herbarium concept and the largest herbaria in the world and how to prepare a herbarium. That means herbarium techniques, herbarium applications, and the references. So what is a herbarium? So herbarium is a depository of plant specimens in dry conditions. So the plants which are collected are pressed dry and preserved in the form of the specimens, herbarium specimens. The collection of the herbarium specimens are utilized for the further reference. So the depository of the plant specimens in dry condition is called as herbarium. So the specimens which are collected are properly dry so that they retain all the essential parts needed for the identification. So they should be dried very properly so that there will be no contamination. So the specimens of the plant species after drying are poisoned, mounted on a paper bag and properly labeled. The label contains the field data including the name of the species, field number, area, date of collection, and name of the collector. So this is about the concept of the herbarium. So as we discussed earlier, herbarium is a collection of preserved plant specimens and they are arranged according to known system of classification to facilitate the identification, nomenclature, and the preserved record of the plants. So the specimens maybe whole plants or the plant parts which are properly dried and pressed, taking care that they retain all essential parts necessary for identification. So certain plants which are either succulents or otherwise unsuitable for pressing and drying techniques are preserved in suitable liquid preservatives such as formaldehyde or formalin aceto alcohol. It is also called as FAA solution in 5:5:90 ratio. That means 5 parts of the formalin and 5 parts of acetic acid and 90 parts of alcohol. And conifer cones and palm fronds are stored dry in labeled boxes. Small specimens such as mosses and lichens are air dried and packaged in small paper envelopes. So thus herbarium is a depository usually of dried plant specimens to preserve for all times a series of specimens and notes that will provide the maximum information about the plants. And it was Luca Guini who initiated the art of herbarium making by pressing and sewing the plant specimens on thick sheets of paper. He also credited for developing Pisa Botanical Garden in Italy in 1544. So this art was disseminated throughout Europe by his students, and they mounted the specimens on paper and bound them into books. And so the word herbarium was first applied by Peyton de Tournefort in his book Elements. So now we see the largest herbaria in the world. Museum National d'Histoire Naturelle. It is located in Paris, France, and it contains around 88,77,300 specimens. And the Royal Botanical Gardens, which is located in Kew, England, it consists of 60 lakhs of the plant specimens. And also New York Botanical Garden, located in New York, USA, it also consists of 60 lakh plant specimens. And Komarov Botanical Institute, located in St. Petersburg, Russia, it consists of 57,70,000 plant specimens. And Swedish Museum of Natural History, located in Stockholm, Sweden, it consists of 56 lakhs plant specimens. And finally, the Natural History Museum, located in London, England, consists of 53 lakhs of the plant specimens. So now we see the step by step the techniques involved in the herbarium preparation. And the preparation of a herbarium involves field visits and collection of specimens, next pressing and drying, and mounting on a herbarium sheet, poisoning, and finally labeling. So now we see about the first step in the herbarium preparation, that is the field visits and collection of the specimens. So field visits, the purpose of field visit is to collect the plant specimens from their natural locality. So we have to visit the plants where they are located. So we have to undergo some field trips. A complete specimen possesses all parts, including root system, flowers, and fruits, need to be collected. So when we have the field visits in that field area, so we have to survey the plants which are located in that area. First, in the beginning, we have to plan a survey, and based on the survey, we'll have an idea about the distribution of the flora in that area. Then in the fields, we need to use some of the tools. So when we plan for the visit, for the field visit, we have to accompany with all the tools and the apparatus required for the collection of the plant specimens and their preservation. And in the fields, the tools required are mainly trowel or digger for digging roots, scissors and knife for cutting twigs. So we can use different tools like cutters and digger, vasculum for the preservation of the plant specimens. And this is the plant press. After collection of the plants, these plants should be kept under the covers of the this absorption sheets under the this plant press, and this is the herbarium sheet. So we have to use scissors and knife for cutting the twigs, and a stick with a hook for collection of parts of all trees. So when we collect some fruits or flowers from the trees, we have to use a stick with a hook. And also finally, we need a field notebook to note down all the details from where this plant specimen is collected, and the locality, the altitude and longitudes of that area, and the type of the soil of that area. So such details should be entered in the field notebook, and the twigs which are collected can be preserved within the polythene bag, and we have to use some old newspapers also for the preservation under the plant press. And next, pressing and drying. Now we see this is the herbarium press. Here the collected plants are there. So after bringing them into the laboratory, the specimens, plant specimens which are collected from the field, are spread out between the folds of old newspapers or blotting sheets. So for the purpose of the pressing, we can use either the old newspapers, which can be available very easily, or we can also get preferably some blotting sheets from the stationery shops. So what they do when we use them in the herbarium press or plant press, they absorb the moisture from the plant parts while they are being pressed. So the specimens, if they are larger, then they might be folded in the shape of the N or W. And we have to keep these plant specimens in a spreaded form, not as it is like that. So we have to keep them on the blotting sheets, and we have to spread the plant spots apart so that we can recognize them very clearly. Each leaf or flowers, all should be, we have to keep them away and apart so that they cannot be folded. So we have to remove the folds of the plant leaves, and we have to properly spread the leaves and the floral parts separately. We have to separate, we have to keep them apart so that they can be distinguished easily. So if they are larger, then we can keep them in the form of N or W shapes. And then we have to keep them between the folds of the newspapers or the blotting sheets. The plant specimen should be placed in the plant press for drying. So in between the here, we have to keep open, and in between the newspaper folds or in between the blotting sheet papers, whichever we use, we have to keep them between the paper folds in a proper way. And then we have to close the plant press very tightly, so that with the pressure of the plant press, it should be pressed very tightly so that the plant parts are pressed properly. We can also keep some weight on the top of the plant press so that it is pressed very properly. So to get the best plant specimen, herbarium specimens, the plant should be pressed very tightly so that all the moisture come out from the plant parts, and it is absorbed by the blotting sheets or newspapers. So it will be quickly dried. So after 24 to 48 hours, the press can be opened. And now the next step is mounting. Now you see the plant which is properly dried is removed from the plant press. So it is totally dried. So it is there are no folds here in the plant parts. So it is removed from the plant press and it should be mounted on the specimen on the herbarium sheet. So we can use the standard size 41 into 29 centimeters of the plant specimen, that herbarium sheet, that is a quality herbarium sheet, and mounting is done with the help of glue, adhesives or sellotape. So we have to properly keep on the at the center of the herbarium sheet, and we have to mount that plant specimen with the help of the glue, adhesive or cellophane tape. And also sometimes it is better to stitch the plant onto the onto the herbarium sheet with the help of the thread, so that it will not fall away from the herbarium sheet. So once the herbarium sheet is prepared, it should be preserved for several years. For example, in Royal Botanical Gardens, we can find the herbarium sheets which are older than 100 years. So to keep them for several years, we have to keep them properly. They should be tightly stitched, or the adhesives or cellophane tapes are they should be stitched properly, so that they are preserved for several years. So this process is called mounting the specimen. And next step is poisoning. So once it is mounted onto the herbarium sheet, that mounted specimen, plant specimen should be sprayed with fungicide 2% solution of mercuric chloride. So mercuric chloride is a fungicide, so it should be sprayed onto the plant specimen so that all the microorganisms, the pests are removed. It is just like sterilization, so that there will be no contamination. And also sometimes if there is any moisture, it may attract some fungal contamination. So to remove mainly fungal contamination, we have to use 2% mercury chloride in ethyl alcohol. So we have to weigh 2 grams of the mercury chloride, and we have to dissolve that 2 grams of mercury chloride in 100 ml of ethyl alcohol. Then that is called as 2% mercury chloride in ethyl alcohol. So we should take a lot of care while we deal with the mercury chloride, as it is a poisonous substance. So we have to wear the gloves while we do this poisoning part. And once it is poisoned, that means when the plant specimen is treated with the fungicide, then we have to keep it for some few minutes so that it will be dried. Then we have to label the sheet. So we have to use a label, paper label or printed label, and that label is pasted or printed on the lower right hand corner of the herbarium sheet. So the label should indicate the information about the locality. So now we see several herbarium specimens here. At the lower hand side, we see the label. So it consists of the, so we see the label here. It contains the information about the name of the plant specimen, family, locality where it is collected. So such details are given on the herbarium on the label. So a label is pasted or printed on the lower right hand corner of the plant herbarium sheet, and the label indicate information about the locality. And in the beginning, we have to give the common name, the botanical name, the locality where it is collected, and the altitude, habit, date of collection, and time of collection, name of the collector, and complete scientific name, etc. So that it will be recognized later. And after the preparation of the herbarium sheet, it should be properly stored. It is very essential. So the properly dried, pressed, and identified plant specimens are placed in thin paper folds. These are called as specimen covers, and which are kept together in thicker paper folders, genus covers. And finally, they are incorporated into the herbarium cupboards in their proper position according to a well-known system of classification. So once a plant specimen is collected and it is properly dried, and it is press dried, and it is identified, then it is poisoned with the fungicide, then later we have to mount the plant specimen onto the herbarium sheet, and we have to keep the label on the lower right hand side of the herbarium sheet, and we have to enter the details of the plant on the label. Later it is preserved in the cupboards of the herbarium cabinet. So we have to preserve the herbarium sheets in the herbarium cabinet cupboards. And in India, Bentham and Hooker's system of classification is used for classification purpose. So once plant is collected, the first step is it is press dried. Then it is mounted onto the herbarium sheet and it is poisoned. Then we have to identify the plant, and we have to give the details of the plant name, common name, scientific name, and locality of collection, and the collector name, who collected that plant. And such details are given on the label, and it should be pasted on the lower right corner of the sheet. And we have to classify the plant also as per the different systems of classifications are there, but we use the natural system of classification, Bentham and Hooker's system of classification, usually in our India. And as per the classification, we have to mention the name of the family. And type specimens are generally stored in separate and safe places, because type specimens are essential for the identification of the plant. Once if a new plant species is identified, then we have to provide the type specimen for the identification, so that we have to keep the type specimens very safely in a safe place. That means the area should be without moisture. It should be well ventilated, and with proper lighting and aeration in such area, they should be preserved. Now we see some of the herbarium sheets collected by me. This is Ipomia eriocarpa. It belongs to the family Convolvulaceae. As per Bentham and Hooker's classification, and the locality is Chityal Reserve Forest area. And this one also belongs to Convolvulaceae family. This is Ipomia quamoclite. It also belongs to Convolvulaceae family, and it is collected from Chityal Reserve Forest area, Nalgonda district. And now we see this is Caparis divaricata. Belongs to Caparidaceae family, or Kapparesi family. It is collected from the Nagarjun Sagar area, Nalgonda district. And this is the field study, field trip for the collection of the plants. So there are several, this is a Bahinia racemosa and this is cactus. So various plants are collected and they are kept in the polythene bag. And after that, they are press dried and labeled onto the, they are mounted. And after that, poisoned, and a label is kept at the right corner bottom of the herbarium sheet with the details of the name and the family of the plant and locality, date, and the identification features of the plant and the name of the collector. So all the details are given on the label. So these are the herbarium specimens. So this plant is Cassia italica. This is Teprosia strigosa, and this is Alsicarpus mahabubnagarensis. So this belongs to Fabaceae, this belongs to Cisalpinaceae, this also belongs to Fabaceae. So now we see what are the applications of the herbarium. Herbaria are the, so the plural form of the herbarium is herbaria. So herbaria are the main source of data for the field of botany called taxonomy. So in taxonomy, it is essential to preserve the plants of the area or flora of the area in the form of the herbaria for the further reference. Plant taxonomists study the biodiversity of a particular region of the world for the floristic research, or the relationships among members of a particular group of organisms for the monographic research. So for the taxonomists, preparation of the herbarium is compulsory. So to assess the biodiversity of a particular area, so we can identify the flora, the different flowering plants of area, because from one region to another region, the distribution of the flora differs. So we can find some kinds of the plants, flowering plants in one area, depending on the soil type and depending on the atmosphere, moisture, temperature, depending on the altitude, longitude, and so depending on the geographical locality, the distribution of the flora varies. So we have to assess the flora distribution in a particular area, and where we have to assess the different plants belong to different families, and also we can also identify the specific plants, and those are called as endemic plants, which grow only in such areas. So this is called as biodiversity. The plants belongs to different families. We can identify, that means we have to assess the biodiversity of the area. So after assessing the flora distribution, we have to collect all the plants and we have to preserve them in the form of the herbaria. And we have to document the details of the flora of that area. So we have to document them step by step based on the families. So the name of the plant and the family to which that plant belongs. So we can also assess the dominant species of that area, dominant genera of that area, and dominant families of that area. So which family is dominant in that area can be assessed. So we can have the statistical data of the distribution of the flora belong to that area. And although a plant looks different when it is dried compared to when it is growing in nature, most of the key features needed for taxonomic studies can be found in a well-prepared herbaria. So sometimes when we press dried the plant, it may lose some color But still, it is very easy to compare the key characters of that plant specimen with the plant which is collected later, so that we can match the morphological features of the both the plants, and we can identify whether the collected plant is same or not, so that we can identify. Once the plant is identified and preserved in the form of the herbarium sheet, it will be easier for the further identifications. When the students collected some plant, and when they come for the identification of that plant, then we can show the herbarium sheet and we can ask them to compare the key identification features, and we can identify that plant. And herbarium is a source of knowledge about the flora of a region or a locality or a country. So herbarium, it is a source of knowledge. So it gives the idea about the kind of the flora belongs to that area, which kind of the flora belongs to that area. So based on one country to another country, the flora differs a lot. In desert countries, in Arab countries, the flora is entirely different from the European area, based on the atmospheric conditions, based on the soil types, the flora distribution changes. So we can have the knowledge about the flora, that flora of that area, based on the herbaria. So we can easily refer the herbaria, and instead of going to that area, and it takes a lot of time. So once a taxonomist collected the plants and preserved the plants in the form of the herbaria, then later anyone can go and they can refer that herbaria to identify the plants of that area. And herbarium is a data store in which the information on plants are available. So it acts as a data store about the flora of that area. And the type specimens help in the correct identification of the plants. So type specimens are the ones which are also the herbarium specimens, but which are collected from the original plant, and from which we have to refer for the further identification. That specimen is called as type specimen, which is essential for the correct identification of the plants. And herbarium provides materials for taxonomic and anatomical studies. So the plant material can be further utilized for the further taxonomic and anatomical studies also. And particularly for the typical pollen characters, it is very essential. So we can also collect the pollen grains from the herbarium sheet, and we can process the pollen grains, and we can study the key identification features of the pollen grains. So based on the pollen grains also, we can identify the plants. It is covered under palynology. The study of the pollen grains of the plants is called as palynology. So for the palynological studies also, herbaria is very useful. And morphological characters of the pollen remain unaltered even after storage up to nearly 200 years. So why we use herbarium specimens for collecting the pollen? Because pollen grains cannot be altered, because it contains sporopollinating material. So it can be preserved. The pollen can last for around 200 years, so that we can use any time for the collection of the pollen grain. So herbarium is a source for the collection of the pollen grain also. And it is very much useful in the study of cytology, structure of DNA, numerical taxonomy, chemotaxonomy, etc. It acts as a reservoir of gene pool studies. So the material which is collected later also can be used for the cytological studies, and also for the DNA studies, and numerical taxonomy studies and chemotaxonomy. And because of the herbarium importance, these herbaria have been established at the national and international center. So in India also, we have national herbaria at Calcutta, and we have several, particularly Botanical Survey of India, the centers, centers are located all over India. In Hyderabad also, Botanical Survey of India is located in Tamil Nadu. The main head office located in Calcutta, and the taxonomists from the Botanical Survey of India, they collect the flora of the various regions and they preserve them in the herbaria. So Botanical Survey of India, it maintains the herbaria so that the researchers can go there and they can identify their collected plant material with the help of the already identified plant specimens in the herbaria. And herbarium collection shows the biodiversity of the area and their distribution. So as we discussed earlier, each area has some typical plant species. So some of the species called endemic species, they are located in such areas only. For example, Cycas vedomi, it is located in Tirumala Hills only. And also, we can also refer some plants like Cleome, Viscosa nagarjunakondensis. It is located only in Nagarjunakonda area. So such plants are called as endemic species. There is a danger that they can extinct. So based on the conservation status, they can be mentioned whether they come under endangered species category or different conservation status also we can mention. So it gives the idea about the biodiversity of the area. And now we see some of the specimens. Some of the specimens which are collected. So now we see Anonaceae family herbarium specimens. So this is Artabotrys uncinatus. It is called Manoranjini in Telugu. It belongs to Anonaceae family, and the plants belong to Caparidaceae. So this is Cleome viscosa. It belongs to Caparidaceae. This is also called Kukka vomita in Telugu. And Cleome gynandra, it also belongs to Caparidaceae. And this is called as Tella vomita. And now we come to Malvaceae family. This is Hibiscus cannabinus, popularly called as Gongura, belongs to Malvaceae family. And Abutilon indica, this is called as Tutturbenda or Dubenabenda, belongs to Malvaceae. And Abelmoscus moschatus, it is also called as Kasturibenda, medicinal plant, belongs to Malvaceae. And this is Hibiscus roja sinensis, belongs to Malvaceae, popularly known as Mandara. And Cyda cardifolia, a Chirubenda, belongs to Malvaceae. And Rutaceae, Murraya exotica, it is called as Naga gulungu, belongs to Rutaceae. And Boerhaavia hispida, it belongs to Nyctaginaceae. And this is Ixora singapurensis, it belongs to Rubiaceae family. And Murraya coenigi belongs to Rutaceae. And Citrus aurantifolia, it belongs to Rutaceae. And Meliaceae, this is Ajadirachta indica, belongs to Meliaceae vapa. And Sapindaceae, Cardiospermum helicocarpum, this is Buddha kakra. And Sapinda semarginatus kunkurkaya, soap nut, belongs to Sapindaceae. And Fabaceae, Aracis ibosia, groundnut, belongs to Fabaceae. And Dalbergia sisu irugud belongs to Fabaceae. Ricinus, Rinkosia minima, it belongs to Fabaceae. Pongamia pinnata gonga, it also belongs to Fabaceae. Crotalaria varicosa and Teprosia purpurea vempali and Clitoria ternata, and this is also belongs to Fabaceae. And Dolichos lablab, it is very popular as chikudu, belongs to Fabaceae. Kajanus kajan, so it is a major source of pulses for curry preparation. This is kandulu called, and red gram, and Bahinia alba, this also belongs to Fabaceae. This is white modga, and this is Crotalaria. This also belongs to Fabaceae. Fasciolus mungo minimal belongs to Fabaceae, and Indigofera tinctoria neeli chettu. A dye, blue dye is prepared from this Indigofera tinctoria Fabaceae. And now we come to Cisalpinaceae, Bahinia purpurea, and it is an ornamental plant. Devakanchanamu belongs to Cisalpinaceae. Cassia pulcherrima, it is also an ornamental, belongs to Cisalpinaceae. Bahinia variegata is also ornamental, belongs to Cisalpinaceae. Cassia occidentalis and Cucurbitaceae, this is Coccinia cardifolia, popularly known as Donda. And Mammatica carantia, this popularly known as Kakara. And Plumbaginaceae, Plumbago jailanica chitramoolamu, medicinal plant belongs to Plumbaginaceae. For Apocynaceae raulfia serpentina, this is Sarpaganda. And Convolvulaceae, Evolvulus alcinoides vishnukranta, and Solanus datura metal umetta, Solanum suratensis neela munuka, and you can also see Solanum nigrum, and Lycopersicum esculentum tomato, and Acanthaceae, Crossandra infertibile formis, and this is Adathoda vasica adasaramu, and Andrographis paniculata nailavemu, and Peristropha paniculata, and Rangia respens, and Ruellia tuberosa, and Stachyterpeta indica, and Amaranthaceae, this is called as Erva laneta, this is also called Pindi chettu, very useful for the treatment of the gallbladder stones or kidney stones, Pindi chettu. And Acranthus aspera, it is also very good medicinal plant. Uttarini belongs to Amaranthaceae. Gomphrena decumbens, and Piper longum, Pippali, and belongs to Piperaceae. And Piper nigrum, it also belongs to Myriallu called, belongs to Piperaceae. And Euphorbiaceae, Philanthus samara, Nalavsri, useful for treatment of the jaundice. And Euphorbia hitta, Euphorbiaceae, Ricinus communis amudamo, it is also very useful, castor oil production, Euphorbia hitta, and Croton bond plandianum, this is also Galivana chittu called Euphorbiaceae. Acalypha indica, this is called Muripinda or Pippinti. Emblica officinalis usiri, gooseberry, and in Orchidaceae also Spathoglottis trichota. So Gingivoraceae, and this is Curcuma longa pasupu, and Poaceae, Symbopogon, and Lamiaceae, Tulasi osmum sanctum, and Asteris eclipta alba, Vrungaraja, it is very useful. It is useful for the as a tonic, hair tonic. And Euphotarium species, Asteraceae, and Vernonia cinerea, Asteraceae, and Artemisia vulgaris, Marchpatri, and Tridax procumbens, Gaddichamanthi, Asteraceae, Mimosaceae, Lithoclobium dulcis, Hemacintha, and Teprosia, this is Tenospora cardifolia, belongs Tipatiga, belongs to Minispermiaceae. And Centella asiatica saraswati aku belongs to Apiaceae. Coriandrum kothimira belongs to Apiaceae. And so these are the different plants of the these are the herbarium sheets belong to different. So these are the uses of the herbarium. Thank you so much.